Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. Since we are now in the month of Kislev, the month in which Jews around the world will celebrate the holiday of Chanukah, there's one question that has been burning in my mind and probably in many of yours as well, and that is, what did the menorah in the temple actually look like? Now, the menorah is one of the most important Jewish symbols, and until it was later eclipsed by the Star of David, it was certainly one of the most popular ways that Jews would signify their religious affiliation, especially from the 3rd century on. It is noted as a diaspora phenomenon in particular. Here is a typical example of the menorah from a 1953 photograph, and you can see that it's usually depicted with rounded arms. Of course, the Chanukah menorah has 9 branches, whereas the version in the temple would have 7. Notice also the oversized dreidel here, which I'm not sure why it's quite so big, but perhaps it is an attempt to reach the required minimum size of the Chazon Ish, very important 20th century rabbi. But at any rate, how did the menorah get rounded or straight branches? Those who prefer the straight branched candelabra for the holiday of Chanukah are most likely associated with the Chabad Hasidic movement, and you will see this particular representation in lots of public places, which is kind of a signal motif of the Chabad movement at this time of year, and also on the tops of minivans, like in this Paris photograph from 2009. The leader of the Chabad movement, Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, was very adamant in indicating that this is the appropriate shape of the menorah, and that's why his followers to this day also tend to use this shape of menorah. And the evidence to support this particular design is specifically associated with the thought of Moses Maimonides, very important medieval scholar who lived in the 12th and very early 13th century. And Maimonides, through his son, Abraham, who left no room for doubt, argued that the branches should be straight. Besides Abraham's explicit statement about his father's views, we also have a medieval manuscript in the Oxford Library that has a hand-drawn menorah, and here you can see it looks kind of strange with these round symbols and these triangles, these cups and so on, that are actually described in the biblical text, which incidentally, you know, if the biblical text gave us a very clear, unequivocal point of view as to whether they were round or straight, we wouldn't be having this discussion. But this drawing in this medieval manuscript of Maimonides clearly indicates that his opinion is that they should be straight. Other authorities from that period, however, left either ambiguous descriptions or sided with a rounded version. The evidence for rounded arms to the menorah are significant as well. So perhaps the most well-known is the representation of the menorah on the Arch of Titus. The Arch of Titus was a ceremonial arch constructed in the late 1st century under the Emperor Domitian, and it was designed as a type of post-war propaganda to commemorate the victory over the Judean rebels. On the inside of the arch, you can see there's a bas-relief that actually presents the carrying away of spoils from the temple, and the menorah is prominently displayed here, clearly having round arms. And this is in conformity with the depiction that we have from Josephus, who was the major historian of that period. What is significantly at dispute is the base of the menorah, which does not conform to other descriptions at all, but we're going to focus specifically on the shape of the arms for now. So the question is, do we rely on Josephus and Roman representations of the menorah, which seem to have some historical validity, or do we rely on these medieval thinkers like Maimonides, who presented an entirely different tradition? Well, if you look at some of the rest of the first century archaeological evidence, and in particular, I'm going to rely very heavily on the research of Lee I. Levine, who's a professor at Hebrew University, who did some amazing work with this. Stephen Fine has also done some remarkable work with menorahs in particular. Professor Levine points to several other examples that all come from the late Second Temple period, that is, right up until the destruction of the temple in the year 70. For example, if you look at this archaeological remain of Jason's tomb, this is a tomb from the era of the Hashmonaim, that is the Maccabean generations of kings in Israel, and this is a tomb that's located in Israel. When you go up close under this arch, you'll see that there's actually some bars that have been placed there to prevent people from actually going into the crypts themselves, where there are loculi, which are kind of like little niches in the wall or in the floor that are designed to accept bones, like ossuaries and things like that. A funny story, when I visited this tomb many years ago with my wife and our first two children, and we're looking through the bars at what's going on there, my daughter, who was just about 2 years old at the time, actually slipped through the bars and went straight into the tomb and was looking into these loculi, and we were like, not sure what to do, trying to get her out, but that's another story. At any rate, she got out, she's okay, she's living in New Jersey now, and thank God. Okay, anyways, what do we have inside this tomb? There's some interesting graffiti. And if you look at this image from Professor Levine's book, you can see that number three there, there's kind of a stag, and below it there's an interesting boat. And then number four lists five representations of a menorah. Very crude, obviously, but they all clearly have gently curving branches. So it's impossible to say how this connects to the menorah in the temple. It's reasonable to assume that the graffiti artist here is trying to mark the walls with some kind of Jewish symbol, but it's also difficult to say when exactly this graffiti was inscribed into the walls and whether or not the artist, if I can use that term, was actually familiar with the shape of the temple menorah. So let's skip past this particular example, though it's quite tempting. We also have a coin that's printed by King Antigonus in the year 37 before the Common Era. This is one of the kings of the Hashmonaim, and one may assume that he had a good look at the temple menorah, and this particular coin also represents the arms of the menorah as gently curving. And finally, there are a few other examples, but I'll just include one from Professor Levine's book. This is a wall decoration, a kind of a stucco etching that was found in a Jerusalem home in the upper city, in the Herodian part of the upper city. And it clearly also portrays gently curving arms. So to wrap this all up, we don't know for certain. Maimonides offers one particular vision of Chanukah menorahs, which has been followed by the Chabad tradition in particular. Others suggest the arms were rounded, and there is some archaeological evidence that suggests that that may be more accurate. I hope you found this short video entertaining and maybe even a little bit inspirational as you light your Chanukah menorah this year. I want to mention that I'm hoping to produce a series of videos on Jewish art and artists over the course of the next few months in connection with my preparation for my cruise with Kosher Riverboat Cruises in the region of Italy, which is of course going to be packed with lots of discussions of Jewish art. Please visit the website to learn more about this particular cruise. There are several others, and they're just absolutely fantastic. This particular cruise is going to be especially interesting because I'll be co-teaching with Rabbi Edward Reichman, who is a medical doctor who is also an expert in medical history, medical ethics, and many other areas. This particular cruise is going to be CME accredited for those of you who can use those credits for your professional life, and I think it's going to be an absolutely amazing cruise. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video. I wish you a lichtigen Chanukah. Thanks very much for watching.